The Bible is God speaking to me. I am what the Word of God says I am. I can do what the Word of God says I can do. I have what the Word of God says I possess. I am a believer, not a doubter. My mind is renewed with the Word. Therefore, I'm thinking those thoughts that please my Father. I'm walking by faith and not by sight. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. To God be the glory. Welcome everyone to Spirit Food Christian Center. I'm Pastor Gary Ziegler. To all those who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ in our church, locally, as well as in all those who believe in Christ Jesus around the world, you are welcome. We're going to get right into the Word of God. I trust that you have your Bible, something to write with, something to write on, as we're going to be receiving instruction concerning faith. And we're talking about the principles of faith, the fundamental principles of faith. I like to classify this as faith 103 or faith 101. It all depends on your understanding of the fundamental principle classes on the subject of faith. So get your Bibles. Let's go ahead and hold them in our hands and repeat these words after me. I'm holding in my hand that which I'm holding in my heart, the holy written word of God. The Bible is God speaking to me. I am what the word of God says I am. I can do what the word of God says I can do. I have what the word of God says I possess. I am a believer, not a doubter. Therefore, God's word is being confirmed in my life with signs following in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Open your Bibles, please, to Mark chapter 11, and we'll look at verse 12. Mark the 11th chapter, verse 12. We're talking about the subject of faith, and really we're looking at the fundamentals of faith. In Mark the 11th chapter, here we have instruction on how faith works. Mark chapter 11, verse 12. And on the morrow when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. And this was referring to Jesus. And seeing a fig tree afar off having leaves, he came if happily he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus answered and said unto it, No man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. And when they come to Jerusalem, and Jesus went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. And he would not suffer that any man should carry any vessel through the temple. And he taught, saying unto them, Is it not written, My house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Now notice, his foundation upon which he was speaking was, Is it not written? When you start declaring what you have to say on the basis of what is written, you are in a position of authority. You are in a position whereby God will back you up and God will manifest in your life because God and his word are one. And Jesus acknowledged, isn't it written that the house that God has set up, the embassy, the church, the synagogue, the place where God's people are to gather together and make requests unto him, is it not written that his house should be identified as the house of prayer? Or we could say it this way, the house where people get answers when they put their petition before God. You see, when you have an understanding that God has set up a way in which you as his people, me, you, us, we, as his people can come and pray, then our confidence should be in God and not in man. And the way that we have confidence in God is that we are aware of the power of the spoken word. If you're going to be a person who walks in faith, if you're going to be a person who operates in strong faith, then you must be willing and you must have confidence in the power of your words. We know in Proverbs, the Bible says in the 18th chapter that death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. When you understand that your life is going to be lived on the basis of what you say, then you can have confidence in God, because God reaches out to us according to His word. And because His word is His promise to us, and His word is a revelation of His character to us, then we can have confidence in God when we have confidence in His word. Apparently, in Mark the 11th chapter here, in verse 17, when Jesus shut down the operations of the money changers and those that were doing commerce and business, He shut it down, and He did it on this basis. Is it not written, My house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. When He says, is it not written, He's talking to them on the authority of the word of God. Isaiah 56, verse 7. Isaiah 60, verse 7. Zechariah chapter 2, verse 11. Is it not written, My house shall be identified as the house of prayer? They that were in the synagogue should have been about the business of finding out what was written. Because when you know what is written, then you know what thus saith the Lord, or what God will do in response to whatever you bring to Him. Now, as we're looking at this verse of scripture in Mark the 11th chapter, verse 17, and He taught, saying unto them, Is it not written, My house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves? And let's skip on down to verse 19. And when even was come, He went out of the city. And in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, said unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursed is withered away. And Jesus answering said unto them, Have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Notice in verse 23, For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Somebody says, Well, I don't agree with that. Well, if you don't agree with that, then you're not agreeing with God. And that means that you're not complying with what Jesus said in verse 22. Have faith in God. If you have faith in God and you can't see God, then the only way to have faith in God is to have faith in what He said. And what He says is written. So Jesus is identifying to them that those who have confidence in God have confidence in what God has said. Or we could say it this way, you have confidence in what is written. So my final authority in my life is what is written. And when I know what is written, I know what thus saith the Lord. And if I have God's word on the matter, then I truly have God's power on the matter, because God and His word are one. He is able and He is quick to perform His word. He hastens, or that means He moves quickly to bring His word to pass in the lives of those that trust Him. Now, I remember, you know, as we're looking at these verses of scripture, when Jesus was talking to His disciples, He's letting them know, you must have confidence in God by having confidence in His word. And then the next level up is, If you have confidence when God speaks that his word is good, you must now apply that same principle of having confidence in words that are spoken by God. You must have that same confidence in your own words when you speak. A person who is willing to grow in faith and have faith to move mountains has to have that confidence that when I speak, my words bring that which I declare to pass. Now, if you're a person who has no confidence in words, then you cannot grow in faith. You cannot be a person who will operate by the God kind of faith, because God always operates according to his word. And therefore, we as his children, and we who are told to imitate him, we're told to have confidence in our word. Some Christians have this attitude. Well, I believe in some of the Bible, but not all of the Bible. Well, that means you believe in some of the things God says, but you don't believe in all of the things that God says. And that's a problem for you, because you're not going to be able to grow properly in faith as you should. Unless you believe in the whole Word of God, then you won't have effective life of faith in some of the Word of God. Some people say, what do you mean by that? Well, the part that you do believe because you've received revelation about, yes, you'll get results. But the parts that you don't believe, you can't get results with what you don't trust or have confidence in. So, or if you see God's word and you say, Lord, I see what you say, but I don't believe it. Well, your unbelief will keep you from having results in what God has said. Let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. We're talking about the fundamentals, the foundations of faith. We're talking about the fundamental principles of faith. And I want you to be able to know, if you're going to have faith to move mountains, if you're going to have faith whereby you're confident the supernatural power of God is going to move on your behalf, you must be a person who believes in the power of your words. Because Jesus said, for verily, verily, I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. You must then be a person who has confidence that what you say will come to pass. And live according to that conviction. That means I'm as good as my word. If I give my word, then I know I'm committed to stand behind my word. Are you aware that there are some people that don't have any faith in God because they don't have faith in their own word? They don't think that God means all of what he says, and they don't believe that what they say will come to pass because they don't believe in all of the things that they say. As believers in Christ Jesus, we are called believers. We're told to believe what God says is so. Now, let's look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, and we'll look at verse 15. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures. Underline the words holy scriptures. Because Holy Scriptures is talking about what we have in our lap now, the holy written word of God. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Now let's stop here at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. How did Timothy get faith in Christ Jesus? Because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Romans 10:17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Timothy heard the gospel, the good news of Jesus being Lord and Savior, and Timothy received that word, and therefore he had faith for salvation, which is in Christ Jesus. Read on further in verse 16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for proof, for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Now, I'm going to read that again. This is 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, 16, and 17. And we're talking about the importance of believing the entire Word of God, not some of the Bible, but all of the Bible. Somebody says, well, I don't believe all of the Bible is accurate. Well, if it's not all accurate, if it's not all the Word of God, then you're going to be finding yourself challenged in having faith in God. Because God and His Word are one. And whatever part of His Word you don't believe, that's the part that you don't have confidence in Him, in God. This is 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. I'll say it this way before we read verse 15. Your attitude towards the Word is your attitude towards God. One more time. Your attitude toward the Word is your attitude towards God. If you don't believe in all of the Word, you don't believe in all of God's ability to move on your behalf. If you don't believe that the Word is all given by inspiration of God and is profitable to teach you and instruct you, then the part you don't believe in is the part you will not benefit from. Let's looking at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. And that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures. Circle, highlight, underline the words Holy Scriptures. Which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And thoroughly furnished means you're going to be properly, thoroughly furnished to be able to accomplish the good works of God. He informs us all of the Scripture is given to us to benefit us, to profit us. What part of the Scripture you don't believe is the part you won't get the benefit from. And so Jesus told His disciples when it came to the fig tree in Mark the 11th chapter, He said, have faith in God. Another way of saying that is, have faith in the Word of God. And then He told them how He produced results with the fig tree, and that was, he who speaks and has confidence in his heart that what he says will come to pass, he will have whatsoever he says. If you don't doubt, that means don't entertain doubt, don't allow doubt to talk you out of what you've talked yourself into in reference to trusting God's Word. Now let's look at 2 Kings, the 4th chapter. 2 Kings chapter 4, we'll start on verse 8. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 8. We're going to look at this principle of the spoken word. We who have the capacity right now to read what the Word of God has said and declares, we have the capacity to analyze what has happened in the past and see that there were those in old times how they trusted in God's Word. They trusted in the spoken Word. They trusted in the Word that came from the prophets. And the Word of the prophets was designed always by God to benefit and encourage, to uplift and edify, and to profit those who would receive. You see, when a person recognized a genuine mouthpiece of God, or we call it prophet of God, and they knew that they were used of God to speak God's word, then when they heard that person speak, they said that word is as good as God Himself talking, because God's word will not return void. Now let's look at 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 8. And it fell on a day that Elisha passed to Shunem, where was a great woman, and she constrained him to eat bread. And so it was
that as oft as he passed by, he turned in thither to eat bread. Verse 9, and she said unto her husband, behold now, I perceive that this is an holy man of God, which passeth by us continually. Notice the word I. She says, I perceive. It's interesting how that she and her husband were both discussing the prophet Elisha, but she determined to let her husband know, my estimation of this man is that he is literally a usable mouthpiece of God, and what he says comes to pass. He is a holy man of God. That means he's walking the walk as well as talking the talk. Now, there are those who will talk the talk, but not walk in the walk. And then there are those who walk, but they're not explaining why they're walking the way they are to produce the results. This woman said, I perceive that this is a holy man of God. He's not common. He's not like everybody else. This man really believes that God is alive and well. And this man believes that when he says, thus saith the Lord, he believes that it's God talking through him. And this man believes that what God says is going to come to pass. I love how she said, I perceive that this is a holy man of God. We're looking at 2 Kings chapter 4. Now we're going to look at verse 10. Let us make a little chamber, I pray thee, on the wall, and let us set for him there a bed and a table and a stool and a candlestick. And it shall be, when he cometh to us, that he shall turn in thither. And it fell on a day when he came thither, and he turned into the chamber and lay there. And he said to Gehazi, his servant, call this Shunammite. And when he had called her, she stood before him. And he said unto him, say now unto her, behold, thou hast been careful for us with all this care. What is to be done for thee? Wouldest thou be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the hosts? And she answered, I dwell among my own people. And he said, what then is to be done for her? And Gehazi, which was the servant of Elisha, answered, verily, she hath no child, and her husband is old. And he said, call her. And when he had called her, she stood in the door. And he said, now listen, and he said, not thought, not astral projected, not I feel by emotions, but he said, about this season, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. And he said, and she said, now, when it says, and she said, she's going to say something in response to what he said. Why is it necessary for her to talk? She's talking because she believes the way God operates is by the spoken word. And she heard the man of God speak a word to her that seemed way out there, and it was something that was in her heart and very dear to her. She knew that when he spoke about her having a son, he struck a chord with her, and that chord with her was very deep. It was, she really had a desire in her heart to have a son, but she had no son with her husband who was of old age. And she responded to the man of God when she heard his words. And she said, verse 16, in the middle of verse 16, nay, that means no, my Lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thy handmaid. She didn't say, no, it can't come to pass. She was saying, don't play with me when you start talking about me having a child. I mean, you struck a nerve with me. You reached into my heart, and you're opening up an area of discussion that I've had with God, not with you. And since that is the case, you have talked to me about what I've been talking about with God. And she said, you're telling me that God said, I'm going to have a child about this time of life. I shall embrace a son. He didn't say you're going to embrace a daughter. He didn't say you're going to embrace twins. He didn't say you're going to embrace multiple children. He said you're going to embrace a son. That was extremely specific. And she was like, why you got to go there? You had to reach into my heart and talk to me about something that is dear to me. You see, when you get close to God, don't be shocked and don't be surprised that God reaches into your heart and talks to you about areas that you felt were too deep and too sensitive and too precious to talk with other people. God will talk to you in your heart about that forgiveness for having that abortion. God will talk to you about having a life of prosperity, even though others have told you you never will amount to anything. God will talk to you about being free and sober and not being hooked on those drugs or being hooked on alcohol. And God will talk to you about how that you have the victory in Christ Jesus. And anyone who's told you you'll never amount to anything, you're going to make them a lie by allowing God to be true. In order for God's word to come to pass, you have to acknowledge, I will agree with God. And isn't it wonderful that she said out of her own mouth, nay, my Lord, don't play with me. Or we could say it this way, 2 Kings chapter 4. She said unto him in verse 16, nay, my Lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thy handmaid. In other words, don't you start cutting up now. Well, he wasn't going to cut up with her. He was telling her the truth. But the desire she had was so great. She knew that only God himself could bring it to pass. And as he was speaking what only God could bring to pass. She said, don't you lie to this handmaid. Don't you lie. Don't you cut up. Don't play with me on this. And he was letting her know, I spoke the word and that word will come to pass. How about you? God declares that you're free. You've been delivered from the power of darkness. Do you believe that? You've been translated into the kingdom of God's dear son. Do you believe that you have the victory in Christ Jesus and all things are possible to them that believe? Do you believe thou this? Jesus said in John's gospel, the 11th chapter, concerning Lazarus being raised from the dead. He said, do you believe me? He said that if you believe me, you will see the glory of God. Or we'll say it this way. If you believe me, you'll see the manifestation of what has been declared, what is written, because God is as good as his word. Now we're looking at 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 17. And the woman conceived and bare a son at that season that Elisha had said unto her according to the time of life. And when the child was grown, it fell on a day that he went out to his father to the reapers. And he said unto his father, my head, my head. And he said to a lad, carry him to his mother. And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon and then died. Well, I mean, how else can you describe the situation? It does not look good. It looks like the son is dead. The son that came as a result of God's promise being received, being conceived, being brought forth in this woman's life. Her son of promise is dead. Let's see how she responds to this. In verse 20 of 2 Kings chapter 4. And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon and then died. And she went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God and shut the door upon him and went out. And she called unto her husband and said, send me, I pray thee, one of the young men and one of the asses that I may run to the man of God and come again. And he said, wherefore wilt thou go to him today? It is neither new moon nor Sabbath. And she said, it shall be well. I want you to underline that and highlight in your Bibles. It shall be well. Now, why would she declare it shall be well when she had her son a few moments ago to die in her lap? How can she say it shall be well when her husband is telling her, this ain't a day in which we go have synagogue and mass or we go to church. This is a day where we're just a regular day. Why do you want to go and reach out to the man of God? She didn't say, I'm leaving to go and have an affair with the man of God. She didn't say, I'm going to run away. She said, I'm going to go see the man of God and come back. Why? Because she knew that within the man of God's mouth and heart resided faith. You see, faith operates from the heart and with the mouth. This man of God believed that what things soever he said would come to pass, he would have whatsoever he said. This man of God believed that God's word would be confirmed with signs following. This man of God would not have spoken if God did not tell him. So where did she go when her son died? She went to the originator of life. Why? Because God, who calleth those things that be not as though they were, God brings death from, or God brings life from the dead. God makes alive when there is death present. Why? Because God is a living God and he is greater than death. This woman responded to her husband and said, it shall be well. Now, shall means that it's going to come to pass. Well means it's all good. How can she say that it shall be well in the presence of everything looking bad? Because she understood the power of God is moved by words. It's not moved by circumstances. God's power is moved by confession. And she determined with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto life, it's made unto well-being. And she said, it shall be well. She must have been listening when this man of God was teaching. I mean, after all, she was attending his meetings when he was traveling through town, so much so that she said, you know, he must need a place to rest after he's preached his meetings. So let him stay in an accommodation we'll provide for him, O husband. And sure enough, they had a room in their house for the man of God. This woman was getting blessed because she was learning what faith will do. And she must have been paying attention. That your words have power as long as you believe in your words. And she declared, it shall be well. Now let's read on further, verse 24, 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 24. Then she saddled an ass and said to her servant, drive and go forward, slack not thy riding for me, except I bid thee. So she went and came unto the man of God to Mount Carmel. And it came to pass, when the man of God saw her afar off, that he said to Gehazi, his servant, behold, yonder is the Shunammite. Run now, I pray thee, to meet her, and say unto her. Now, this servant, Gehazi, had a responsibility to carry the message that was being told him of the prophet Elisha. That meant he was to speak exactly what he was told to say, nothing less, nothing more. He was going to be the word that came forth out of the mouth of the prophet. Now, notice in verse 26, run now, I pray thee, to meet her and say unto her, is it well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with the child? Again, verse 26, run now, I pray thee, to meet her and say unto her, is it well with thee? Is it well with thy husband? Is it well with the child? And she answered, it's well with me. It's well with my husband. But the child, oh no, she didn't say that. Notice her response was the same response that she told her husband when her husband was wondering, why are you going to see the man of God? Notice in verse 26, she said, it is well. She called those things that be not apparent as though they already were. What was she looking at? She was looking at it in the natural, the death of her son, but she took her eyes off of the natural and put her eyes on the word that was spoken unto her, which was, you're going to have a child by this time of life. And you're going to have a child that will be a blessing to your heart. This woman responded to the questions that was given unto her. She said, it shall be well. It sounds to me like she's been taking lessons on how faith works. And in her response, it shall be well. Let's look at verse 27. And when she came to the man of God to the hill, she caught him by the feet. And Gehazi came near to thrust her away. And the man of God said, let her alone, for her soul is vexed within her. And the Lord hath hid it from me and hath not told me. Then she said, did I desire a son of my Lord? Did I not say, do not deceive me? Then he said to Gehazi, gird up thy loins and take my staff in thine hand and go thy way. If thou meet any man, salute him not. And if any salute thee, answer him not again, and lay my staff upon the face of the child. And the mother of the child said, as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. I'm not leaving you. And he arose and followed her. I love the fact that this woman says, I understand how power works. Power works by faith. And I told you, O man of God, when you spoke concerning my son, I said, don't lie to me. I said, don't play with me. I said, I am touched by what you said. This woman knew that in order for this to end out or end up very well, it was going to have to be something that faith would produce the results. She knew that she got pregnant by receiving the word of God, and her husband and her were able to have a child when as before they couldn't. She knew that in order for her child to come back to life, she had to have the word of God. She knew that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. She never told the man of God, you lied to me. She just said, did I not tell you? Don't lie to me. And therefore, if I said don't lie to me, that means me having a son means that I would be rejoicing and allow myself to go before my son dies and not my son. I'm watching him die. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 30. And the mother of the child said, as the Lord liveth and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee. And he arose and followed her. And Gehazi passed on before them and laid the staff upon the face of the child. But there was neither voice nor hearing. Wherefore he went again to meet him and told him, saying, the child is not awake. And when Elisha was come into the house, behold, the child was dead and laid upon his bed. And he went in therefore and shut the door upon the twain and prayed unto the Lord. And he went up and lay upon the child and put his mouth upon his mouth and his eyes upon his eyes and his hands upon his hands. And he stretched himself upon the child, and the flesh of the child waxed warm. Now what's going on here? The prophet understands that life abides in the spirit and that the spirit gives life. And he knew that the word was in his spirit. And he knew that if this child was touched by the spirit of God, the anointing of God that was operating through him, he knew that his anointing could bring forth life in this child, because God and his word are one, and God only anoints his word, and the anointing will bring to life that which is dead. Faith in the anointing, faith in the word of God. This is the reason why you don't want to say with your mouth, I believe in some of the Bible and not all of the Bible. The scripture we read earlier was that all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That means that we who believe on all of the word can benefit from all of the word. And what part of the word you don't believe in, that's the part you won't get the benefit from. So have this attitude. Even if I don't understand all of the Bible, I'm going to believe all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for me. I just have to understand it. Now, how do you come to the place where you understand it? The Bible says, study to show yourself approved unto God as a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You have to study it. This word is all given by God for your benefit and for your blessing. Not some of it, not a portion of it, but all of it. And all of it being received will put you in a position where you won't be ashamed and you won't incorrectly divide it. You will correctly divide it and you will not be ashamed, but you will be bold in the word of faith and righteousness. 2 Kings chapter 4 is what we're looking at in verse 35. Let's see here. Yes. Then he returned and walked in the house to and fro and went up and stretched himself upon him. And the child sneezed 7 times. And the child opened his eyes. And he called Gehazi and said, call this Shunammite. So he called her. And when she was come in unto him, he said, take up thy son. Then she went and fell at his feet and bowed herself to the ground and took up her son and went out. See, when you get results with your faith, there's no doubt about it that you can testify of the goodness of God and how your faith produced results. Look at Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews, the 11th chapter. As we look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, and then we'll look at verse 35. Well, let's look at chapter 11, verse 1, verse 6, and then verse 35. We'll skip because you can read the whole chapter all on your own because it speaks about those who received results with their faith. Now, the definition of faith according to the Bible is Hebrews 11, 1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That means faith stands alone. Faith will produce its own results. As long as you hold fast your confession of faith, as long as you believe in your heart what God has said and then confess it out of your mouth, you're going to receive God's word being confirmed in your life with signs following. Some people say, well, I'm not getting results. You may be one scripture away from actually believing in your heart what God says. If you have not embraced in your heart what God says in His Word, then find the scriptures that promises you the solution or the answer to that which you're looking for, and then allow yourself to embrace, comprehend, and confess what God's Word has declared. Looking at Hebrews 11 now, verse 6. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Notice that you can't have confidence in God if you don't believe God is God. There are those who are calling themselves Christians. They believe God can do some things, but not all things. How can you go out and yell at people to get results when you're supposed to talk to God in prayer and get results? You see, I'd much rather talk to my Father in the closet and know that He heard me, the God that created the heavens and the earth, and get results while Him listening, than to run out and yell and scream at people who have no interest in giving me what I desire. Faith in God is what Jesus told us to have in Mark 11, 22. Now look at verse 35 of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 35. It says, faith, women received their dead raised to life again. Women received their dead raised to life again. Now, what's he talking about? If you'll look at that scripture in Hebrews 11, the subject is faith. He's saying that by faith, women received their dead raised to life again. In 2 Kings chapter 4, we saw how this woman, she had to be a person of faith because it's written in Scripture of the account of what took place. And notice how the woman received her dead son raised to life again. What is it that she did? She said what she believed. And what was it that she believed? She believed all is well. When you come to the place where you trust God's word above the circumstances you're facing, then you come to the place where you're operating in the God kind of faith. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. When we're looking at this 2 Corinthians, the fourth chapter, verse 13, we're going to see here that faith is released by the words of our mouth. When you understand that faith is released by the words of your mouth, you start paying attention to what comes out of your mouth. Don't allow your mouth to be a garbage can. Don't allow your mouth to spew out filth and craziness or superfluous conversation or vain talking and foolish jesting. Go ahead and allow your mouth to be used of God so that you can say what is written and receive results. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak. We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written. Remember we said, the God kind of faith is faith in God. How do I have faith in God? It is written. According as it is written, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak. Look at verse 18. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. That means the subject of faith that we're discussing is allowing faith to impact the circumstances you may face. You are not to allow circumstances to govern you. You govern the circumstances by the words of faith and by believing in your heart the promises of God. I love you. I'm so grateful that you were able to tune in and receive this instruction on the fundamentals of faith and how the principles of faith works. Have confidence in your word, and because you do, in the word of God coming out of your mouth, you're going to receive results. I love you, and I thank God for you tuning in.
Salvation is the free gift that the Lord offers anyone who would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10, that with our hearts we believe unto righteousness, and with our mouth confession is made unto salvation. I trust that you will believe God's word, that your faith will be in the risen Savior who came to give his life for you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Will you pray with me this prayer of salvation? It's not difficult. It's very easy, but you must mean it from your heart. So repeat these words after me. Jesus, I confess you as my Savior and my Lord. I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead. With my mouth, I confess you and I receive you as my Savior. Jesus, thank you for making my heart your home. Thank you for living in me. God the Father is now my Father, and the Holy Spirit has done a work in me. I am a new creature in Christ Jesus, my Lord. Thank you, Lord, for saving me, and thank you for guiding my life. In Jesus' name, amen. We're here to be a blessing to you at Spirit Food Christian Center. The way this broadcast is brought to you is by people's faithful sowing and reaping as a result of God's word being given unto them. So I want to encourage you, be a part of this ministry of sowing and reaping. The Bible says, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. In this ministry, we believe that man must hear the word of God. For man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. The Bible declares, God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. God loves a cheerful and hilarious giver. I encourage you, be a part of this ministry. Be hilarious in your giving, and watch the Lord bring it back to you in many, many ways. In Jesus' name.
You have been watching the Spirit Food Christian Center Worldwide Webcast online at www.myspiritfood.com. Join us for worship service each Sunday at 9:30 a.m. And be sure to check out our website for our weekly live broadcast and much, much more. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.